we mentioned to you 3 weeks ago where we were in our capital campaign. We wanted to give you the final numbers tonight, or at least where we are as of this point. At that point, 2 weeks ago, I believe we were around $26 million. And I'd like to ask Steve and Kathy Eggener to come, our chairs of our capital campaign, and let us know where we are in our capital campaign at this time.
Since in the last 3 weeks, our totals are now up to 2,245 adults and 69 children, making a total commitment of
$28,231,800.
That is incredible. In the last 3 weeks, over $2 million has been committed towards this effort, and we are very excited, very proud, and grateful for all of you who have done that. We are $1,760,000 away from our goal. I want you to know what that means for us. A couple of things. First of all, just so you know where we're going in the future. The fact that we're not at $30 million doesn't change the cost of the building. It's still the same, regardless of how much we raise. So we have to do one of two things. We have to raise a little more, or we have to cut back in the building, and we're going to try to look at both of those things. And here's what we're doing. We are, the first step in this process will be to encourage you in one way. We want you to know right up front, our past capital campaigns, we've only collected 90% of what was committed. If everyone actually fulfilled their commitments, we will be over the amount we need for that building. But we have to assume that we're going to lose 10% of our commitments again in this campaign. So if you feel pretty confident and you can do the best you can over the next 3 years to fulfill your commitment, we will actually have raised more than what we had targeted at the $30 million number. Are you following me? Because we discounted that to $27 million in the number of commitments we historically lose. That means if you move away and you remember this commitment and you can still fulfill it, that will help us. It means if there's some sermon, here's how we typically lose commitments. I say something in a sermon that makes someone mad. And they send an email and they say, you know, I really didn't like that, and here's now my new commitment, zero. That doesn't happen very often. But let me encourage you, if I ever say anything that makes you mad, just have grace. Grace, lots of grace, all right? And someday I'm sure I'll figure out what I said that was wrong. But that's not usually what happens. Usually it's people moving away or their situations change. If your situation changes and you can't fully remember, that's okay. You need to just be able to let us know that. I lost my job, my situation changed, I can't do it. But I want to encourage you to take this seriously because that will help us get to the place we need to be. The second thing that we want to encourage you to do is to continue to be in prayer. What we will be doing over the next year, by next fall, we will have had about 500 new members join the church. And we are going to be approaching them next fall. What we'll probably do is look at whatever shortfall we have, and that amount of the building we will be leaving unfinished going into the fall. Our hope is that those new members then will be able to help us complete the building. So that's our process, or that's our plan at this point. We've already have some folks who've revised their pledges. In fact, we had probably $500,000 came in from members who said, you know what, I think I could do a little more than I said to begin with. So thank you to those of you who have done that as well. But that's where we're at. We feel great about it. I am very proud of what you have done. And I want to say on behalf of all of the people who will meet Christ here in the future, all the children in those Sunday school classrooms, every adult who will find a seat in the sanctuary who didn't know Christ before, thank you for what you have done. You are an amazing group of people. All right, with that in mind, let's take a moment now to pause for a word of prayer as we begin our service of worship. Oh God, we gather in this place as your people, called by your name. And we come to worship you. We thank you for the amazing things you've done in our midst. For the joy that we have through Jesus Christ. Pour out your Spirit on us tonight, we pray, and help us to worship you in His name. Amen. Let's stand together as we worship the Lord.
In my heart.
to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
You came from heaven.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
Amen. Thank you, Father. Only a God like you. That's the name that we lift on high, the name of Jesus Christ.
Took the time to say gave that one lost lamb to only the king who wore that crown of thorns, so I could wear the crown of life, and to only the one who conquered sin and death, so we could be set free, so we could stand here and sing, yeah.
Only a God like you, only a God like you, only a God like you.
Thank you, Father. The Lord gives us so many things. One of those things is times of rest. I heard the voice of God calling out my name. Come unto me and rest. I heard the voice of God calling out my name. Come unto me and rest, and I will hold you in arms that are forever, and I will lead you beside rivers that run deep, and I will teach you as we walk together. Come and follow me.
And I heard the voice of God.
I heard the voice of God calling out my name.
That song is a wonderful transition to baptism, because in baptism, Christ is calling us to come and follow him. In fact, tonight, Christ is calling in particular Justin. And I wonder, as you think back in your own memory of a time where you began a relationship with someone that was important to you, maybe it was a spouse, or maybe it's your earliest memories of a good friendship, Baptism is the beginning of that relationship that we have with Christ and Christ with us. Actually, it even goes before baptism. From the moment we're being formed in our mother's womb, God is shaping us and molding us. But in baptism, God formally promises to us that He claims us as His children, that He'll give us life now and life eternal, that He gives us a church family, and that He will forgive our sins and remember them no more. And in our baptisms, we or our parents on our behalf pledge to follow Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord and serve Him faithfully with God's people all of our days. So tonight, Dale and Renee, as you present your son for baptism, I ask the two of you, will you do everything you can to demonstrate the love of Christ to your son, to teach him and show him by your words and by your example what it means to be a faithful follower of Jesus? And then will you raise him in the church so that from God's covenant people, he can continue to grow in his faith here in Sunday school and Vacation Bible School and someday through confirmation, profess for himself the Lord Jesus? Very good. And I want to ask you, Jennifer, will you continue to be a good big sister? Yeah. All right. Would you come see me? Right there. Okay, you can stay with Mom. Come right over here, a little closer. All right. What name is given this child?
Justin Dale Blake.
Justin Dale Blake. We baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And Justin, I make the sign of the cross on your forehead as a reminder that Jesus lives in your heart. And now may the Holy Spirit fill you that you might grow up to be a great man of faith. Amen and amen. I don't know whose a wet hand is that on your head, right? Well, I want to ask all of you, when we're baptized into the body of Christ, into the church, and we're going to need people, even if we don't understand that when we're little, we're going to need people to help us and encourage us and mentor us and teach us the faith. So I ask you, will you be Justin's church family? Very good. Let's pray together for him and for his family. Lord God, we give you thanks and praise for the blessings that you give us and children. We thank you for Justin and Jennifer. We thank you, O God, for Dale and Renee. We pray that you would bless them and keep them all of your days. Allow Justin's walk with you to grow stronger and deeper day by day, and bless this family with faith, hope, and love, now and forever. Amen.
Good evening. Scripture says, "For the Lord is good, and his mercies do not fail us. For the Lord is good." Lift your voice and say, "The Lord is good." Each week in our worship services, we take time to remember those in our body who grieve the loss of loved ones. Let me bring to your attention a few families in particular. Marilyn Teason and their family upon the death of Marilyn's brother. Gene Smith and family upon the death of Gene's mother. Joanne Trussell and their family upon the death of Joanne's mother, and John Pitney and their family upon the death of John's mother. Several months ago, Adam spoke to us in his series on contemporary issues in the faith about missionaries Martin and Gracia Burnham. We prayed for them that day and have prayed for them often since. And now we know the tragic outcome of the loss of Martin's life. Let's remember in our prayers this evening that family in particular, but the countless thousands and tens of thousands of families that they represent for those who serve the kingdom of God and the purposes of His rule and reign in preaching the gospel on distant shores, for those that suffer this evening for the sake of righteousness, for those who are imprisoned and suffer for the sake of the gospel. Jesus pronounced a particular blessing upon those who suffer persecution for His name's sake. And so together, let's be the church in prayer on behalf of those who suffer. Let's pray together. Our gracious God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the God of all comfort, we pray that you might comfort the Burnham family and the news of the loss of Martin. We pray for his wife that you might grant her a speedy recovery, a safe passage home, and a reunion with their children and church family and extended loved ones. Lord, we pray your healing, your grace and mercy upon them. We thank you for the testimony of this life, that although Martin has died, he still speaks to us and still lives. We thank you for the testimony of Jesus Christ in our city and in our country and around the world. We pray for those who suffer a similar plight in other parts of the world, whose stories have gone unnoticed and unrecognized. Lord, we pray for your church around the world, that it might be strengthened and empowered. We pray for ourselves as we're humbled at the example of others' commitment to you. We ask that you would be gracious and forgive us for what is so often our casual attitude toward you. We think of the sobering text in the Revelation that says, your saints overcome the power of darkness by the word of their testimony, the blood of the Lamb, that they love not their lives even unto death. And we thank you, Jesus Christ, that you gave your life for us. By your death we live. And this evening, as we gather in your name, we remember the words, Lord, that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Jeff. At this time, I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward, and they'll be handing you the attendance notebooks. If you would please sign in and let us know that you were here, we'd be most grateful. And as you're signing in, take a look and see who's sitting next to you, and be sure to welcome those people by name immediately following the service of worship. If you're a first-time visitor, the information on the left-hand side is there for you to take. We encourage you to help yourself. And now I'd like to invite you to listen carefully and prepare your hearts to hear God's word in song.
Praise you.
In the ancient world, whenever the king spoke, people stood to attention. So let's stand together for the reading of God's word. Reading from Luke's narrative in the 13th chapter of the book of Acts, we read these words. Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers: Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manion, a member of the court of Herod, the ruler, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." Then after fasting and praying, they laid their hands on them and sent them off. May God bless the teaching, the listening, and the doing of His word. You may be seated.
As you're seated, I'd like to invite you to please take out of your bulletin your sermon notes and study guide. The sermon notes are an outline of today's message. I'd encourage you to follow along and write down the things you'd like to remember and reflect on during the week. The study guide is an opportunity for you to do your own Bible study, and I know that you will be blessed this week as you take the time to read these scripture readings as we continue to study the life and journeys of the Apostle Paul. Now, in this series of sermons, we're doing something a little different than we normally do. Generally, in my sermons, I begin with the human condition. My focus here in most sermons is to begin by looking at where we live, where we scratch, where we itch, where we struggle, and then trying to look at what the Bible has to say about that. But in this series of sermons, we're taking the reverse approach. We're beginning with what the biblical text has to say, and then searching for bridges to build between the first century and the stories of the Apostle Paul and our own lives today. And part of what we're doing that's just a smidge different than normal is a bit of Bible study. Now, I enjoy leading Bible study, teaching Bible study, so I'm going to ask for your permission during this series of sermons to take about the first 10 or 15 minutes of each sermon and just do Bible study with you, and then invite you to dig deeper yourselves using your study guides. Now, I'm having a blast preparing these sermons because I've been able to immerse myself in things of Paul in a way that I haven't done since I was in seminary, and it really has been a joy. I'd like to share with you a couple of the things that I learned this week that I hadn't put together in my prior studies. First of all, we're going to begin by looking at this passage that Jeff just read for us from Acts chapter 13, Paul's first missionary journey. And then we're going to quickly move to one particular place where Paul was preaching in that missionary journey in the town of Lystra. If you have your Bible, I want you to open up to Acts chapter 13 and leave it there, and we're going to flip back and forth between Acts 13, 14, and 12 today. Let's begin, though, with this passage from Acts 13, something fascinating that we find in this passage of Scripture. We learned 2 weeks ago that Antioch was the third largest city in the Roman Empire at that time. Antioch was on the eastern coast of the Mediterranean Sea, just north of Israel in modern-day Syria. Third largest city in the Roman Empire, it quickly became the most important city in early Christianity. There was Jerusalem first, and then there was Antioch, and then finally the center of Christianity moved to Rome. At this time, Antioch is becoming the center of the Christian faith, and from here the mission is going to go out to the rest of the world. There are in this town 5 key leaders, and this is just a fascinating piece of information that I want you to have tonight. Really not the focus of our sermon, just something I want you to reflect on through the week. 5 key leaders in the city of Antioch who were heading up the church and the activities that were there. Did you notice the names? They were Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Simeon, whose name was Niger, Barnabas, and Paul. These are the 5 key leaders, or Saul, the 5 key leaders in the town of Antioch. But here's what I want you to notice about them. One of them in particular, Simeon, who was called Niger. F.F. Bruce makes a wonderful case about Simeon of Niger in his book, Paul the Apostle of the Heart Set Free, that I had not noticed, though I had read that case before. Simeon was also the Latinized version of the name Simon. Now, Simon is someone that he is able to link together with the Simon from Mark's Gospel, Simon from Cyrene. That's interesting. You may remember Simon from Cyrene, which was in the northern part of Africa, was the man who was forced into carrying Jesus' cross. In the Gospel of Mark, we learn that Simon of Cyrene had 2 sons. And those sons are mentioned by name, not only in Mark's gospel, which was aimed at the city of Rome, but also in Paul's letter to the Romans. And Paul mentions these two sons by name, gives a greeting to them, and speaks of their mother, who would have been Simon's wife, as someone who was like a mother to him, linking all of these things back to Simon of Antioch. Now, it gets even more interesting because Simeon, whose surname was Niger, you may remember that Niger was the Latin word for black. And it was likely that this man was a black African. Now, here's what gets really compelling in my mind. Among the five key leaders in the Church of Antioch in the first century, probably the most important leaders in the church outside of the apostles in the city of Jerusalem, we have a Cypriot, a man from the island of Cyprus, that was Barnabas. We have a Turk, that was Saul or Paul, who was from modern-day Turkey. We have Lucius from Cyrene, which was also northern Africa, perhaps where Libya is today. And we have Simon, or Simeon, who was a black African. And what this tells me is that in the early church was colorblind. The gospel was very clear to them that that was completely irrelevant. Those colors and distinctions between people were irrelevant in the early church, unlike any other place in society. That God was calling people, whether they were black or they were olive or they were white, to be leaders in his church. That God was calling people who were Roman citizens, like the Apostle Paul, and some who were slaves. He was calling both men and women. He was calling people who were patricians and people who were plebeians. In fact, Menean, we find out, was a playmate of Herod the king. What a wide diversity of people who were called by God to be leaders in the early church. I just found that profound as I was reading that. It may not speak to you, but it spoke to me about the heart of God and the leaders that God called in the early church. Now, let's turn for a moment then to the first missionary journey. If you have a Bible with maps in the back, and if you don't have one, I'd encourage you to get a study Bible that has maps in the back because they're very, very helpful for us. If you have one of those kind of Bibles, keep your finger at Acts chapter 12 and turn to the back and find a map. Usually it'll say the journeys of Paul or Paul's early travels. And I want you to look at that. If you didn't bring a Bible like that, you'll find a map on the video screen. But as you can see, it's a little harder to see up there. Now on the far right-hand side of the screen where all of those arrows begin, that little dot is Antioch. Syrian Antioch, and you'll see the journeys of Paul. Let's go to the next slide. Here we are up close, and you can see that Paul takes this first missionary journey. The believers at Antioch are called by the Holy Spirit to send Christians out into the world to take the gospel, and they travel on this pathway or trajectory, about 1,000 miles by ship, horseback, and by foot. Paul travels on his first missionary journey, which is his shortest journey. He travels from, leave the map up for a few minutes, he travels from Antioch to Cyprus first by ship. And at Cyprus, which is the homeland of Barnabas, they spend some time traveling by foot across Cyprus, preaching the gospel anywhere they can. And they convert both Jews and Gentiles there. They bring people to faith in the Jewish Messiah. Then they board a ship at Paphos, and they make their way north to the Turkish coast, to the town of Perga. And they begin traveling from Perga, preaching the gospel there, no doubt, to another city called Antioch, this one Pisidian Antioch, which is not the same as the Syrian Antioch where they began. They preach the gospel in Antioch, and they begin what is a familiar habit when you read the book of Acts. They start out preaching the gospel in the synagogue. Paul believes he should take the gospel first to the Jews, and only then, after offering it to the Jews, to the Gentiles. And he preaches there. We learned a couple of weeks ago that there were Gentiles who worshipped in the synagogue too, who had not converted to Judaism. They were called God-fearers. And as he preaches, you have the chance to read in your study guide reading this week the first sermon that we have recorded of the Apostle Paul. It's listed there in Acts chapter 12 or Acts chapter 13. And you'll have a chance to hear what he has to say. He preaches there, and there are some Jews who come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, and there are also many of the God-fearers. And they beg them, Paul and Barnabas, stick around for another week. We want to hear more about this Messiah you're preaching on. So Paul and Barnabas stay around for a week. They no doubt minister throughout the town and village. And the next Sunday, it's a big thing, or next Saturday in the Sabbath, it's a big thing. The whole town comes out to hear what Paul and Barnabas have to say. Not only the Jews, but also the Gentiles. And it's standing room only. I mean, they're sitting out in the narthex. They've got 27-inch TV screens out there trying to make sure that everyone can see. And they share with them the gospel. Now, there are a group of people who become jealous. This is what happens in every town and village that Paul comes to. They're jealous and they're also upset. They're upset because what are all these Gentiles doing in our place? And they stir up the crowds against Paul and Barnabas. Nevertheless, there are many God-fearers, Gentiles, and Jews who come to believe and put their trust in Jesus. They're run out of town before they're stoned to death. Now, they go on from there to the town of Iconium. Iconium was not too far away. I believe it was about 90 miles away. And as they were in Iconium, they begin to see the same thing happen. They offer the gospel in the synagogue. There are some God-fearers, some Jews, some Gentiles who come to believe. But before long, the people who are there, the leaders in the synagogue, become upset, and they get ready to stone Paul and Barnabas for heresy. They're going to kick them out of town. They're going to do worse than that. They're going to kill them. So Paul and Barnabas quickly flee the scene when they hear word of this plot, and they begin to run for their lives. You remember, Paul was a persecutor of Christians. Now he's experiencing a taste of what he had also given to others. But there's an interesting thing that happens in Iconium that's not recorded in the book of Acts. In fact, there's a whole lot of traditions that began to circulate after Paul's death about things that he did. And about 175 AD, an elder in the church in what is modern-day Turkey decided to gather all of these traditions about the Apostle Paul together. It's 175. These are traditions that had circulated for about 100 years. And he put them together in a book called The Acts of Paul. This was not meant to be a biblical book. It was meant to be just a gathering of as much information as we could get about Paul. Some scholars believe that some of those legends are probably true, and some perhaps not. We really don't know. But there's one that takes place near Iconium, and I thought I'd share it with you because it's the only early recorded account of what Paul may have looked like. You interested in what Paul looked like? So was I. Here's what it says. A man named Onesiphorus, who had heard that Paul had come to Iconium, went with his children and his wife to meet Paul. Titus had told him what Paul looked like, and he saw Paul coming. Here we go. A man small of stature, with a bald head and crooked legs, in a good state of body, with eyebrows meeting and nose somewhat hooked, full of friendliness, for now he appeared like a man, and now he had the face of an angel. I found that interesting. Now, from Iconium, Paul and Barnabas set out for Lystra, perhaps some 25 miles away. And it's there that our story takes place that I'd like to focus on in this evening's sermon. Let's take a look at what happens to Paul and Barnabas in the town of Lystra. If you have your Bible, turn to Acts chapter 14. We'll look beginning at the 8th verse. And allow me to read this to you. In Lystra, there was a man sitting who could not use his feet and had never walked, for he had been crippled from birth. He listened to Paul as Paul was speaking. And then Paul, looking at him intently and seeing that he had faith to be healed, said in a loud voice, "Stand upright and walk." And the man sprang up and began to walk. When the crowd saw what Paul had done, they shouted in the Lyconian language, "The gods have come down to us in human form." Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul they called Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. The priests of Zeus, whose temple was just outside the city, brought oxen and garlands to the gates. He and the crowd wanted to offer sacrifice. When the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of it, they tore their clothes and rushed out into the crowd, shouting, "Friends, why are you doing this? We are mortals just like you, and we bring you good news that you should turn from these worthless things to the living God who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them." Even with these words, they scarcely restrained the crowds from offering sacrifice to them. Now, local legend had it that Zeus and Mercury had come to Lystra sometime in the past, Zeus and Hermes. You may remember that Hermes or Mercury, one and the same god, was the messenger god. And no doubt that's why that Mercury was, or Paul was considered to be Mercury. He was the speaker of the crowd. And he was the one who showed people the way to Hades or to death and navigating through the afterlife. Now, Paul and Barnabas had been used to, in the last couple of villages, being kicked out, run out of town, ready to be stoned to death. They come to Lystra and they achieve a huge measure of success. Imagine that. I mean, the people think they're gods. That had to be a kind of a nice welcome change from the sort of reception that they'd had in the last couple of villages. And something miraculous had indeed happened. And you can almost imagine what Paul might have been thinking. I mean, certainly he was horrified that they wanted to offer sacrifices to him, but at the same time, you know, these people must think I'm pretty good. I mean, they think I'm Mercury, I'm Hermes, I'm the silver-tongued God. And look at the powerful things that God did through me. And certainly there may have been at least some temptation to sort of run with the thing for just a little while. You know, just to let them play it out for a while, a little nice steak dinner, some vino, and then maybe they could set them straight. At least they could have a hearing if these folks actually believe they were gods. But of course, Paul and Barnabas would have no part of that. It wasn't within their character that they could allow this to go on. Now, this story is interestingly juxtaposed against a story in Acts chapter 12. Luke knows what he's doing. In Acts chapter 12, he tells us the story of King Herod Agrippa. And we're almost done with the Bible study. We'll jump into the sermon here in a second. So stay with me for a moment. If you have your Bible, turn to chapter 12, verses 20 through 23. Here we find a very interesting story. King Herod Agrippa I, who is the tetrarch or the ruler over Galilee, is entertaining some guests from Phoenicia, that is Tyre and Sidon, the land right along the seacoast at the Mediterranean Sea. And they don't like Herod at all. They really don't. They just have no positive feelings about him, but he holds the grain. All the food comes from Herod Agrippa I. So they come to him, and he gives them an audience, and Josephus, the historian, tells us he's dressed in silver robes, and there he sits listening to them, and he gives a little speech, and as soon as he's finished, you know what they say? Why, this is the voice of a god. Now, you're not even a mortal, Herod. You are amazing. The things you say just drip with wisdom. We want to hear more of what you have to say. Only Herod didn't say, wait a second, what are you all saying? I'm just a mortal just like you. But he accepts the accolades. He's puffed up and filled with conceit. And he gets his just rewards. You really need to hear this part of the story. The scripture says that he immediately falls over and he dies of worms. Not a pleasant thing to die of in the first century or today. What an interesting contrast. We have King Herod Agrippa, who accepts the accolades and praise and is filled with conceit. And we have Paul and Barnabas, who are hailed as a god because they've done something miraculous and amazing. And they would have no part of the people believing that they were gods. Now, in the time that remains, I'd like to build two bridges between these stories in Lystra and our story in this room in the city of Leawood today. The first is that success can be very, very dangerous. Success can be dangerous. Now, success comes in a variety of forms. There are some of you who most of us would consider quite successful. But my hunch is that all of us at some point in our lives in some place will measure a degree of success. It may be in athletics. It may be in our appearance, it may be in our career, or it may be in some other area of life. But somewhere along the way, we're going to achieve. We're going to beat someone else out in the sales figures. We'll be the top salesperson for the month, or we're going to have succeeded in some other place. But all of us in this room, somewhere along the way, will taste a measure of success. And that's great, and success is sweet, and there's nothing wrong with succeeding. Succeeding is not a bad thing. It's what it does to you that can be bad. Success can be dangerous to our souls. Some years ago, I shared with you, actually it's been 7 or 8 years ago, I shared with you a story of something my father-in-law said to me. My father-in-law, LaVon's dad, lives on a farm in central Illinois. And he's just a salt-of-the-earth kind of person, very, very plain-spoken and just a good person. Lives in the same house that his parents lived in before him, a small farmhouse kind of in the middle of nowhere. And I remember when we moved into our first house in South Johnson County. And he came to visit. You know, we were pretty excited. We wanted him to see, you know, our nice house with the hardwood floors and the tile entryway and the center island in the kitchen. But instead of being excited, he just had a bit of advice. Whatever you do, Adam, don't let this change you. You know what he meant? I mean, sometimes when you achieve in your life, it can change you. I remember visiting with a pastor's wife some time ago, probably 10 or 12 years ago. And I was just out of seminary, and I was an associate pastor, and she's telling me about her husband, who was an overachiever. I mean, he'd done really well in the ministry. He was very successful. He was a great preacher and had all kinds of accolades and awards. And one day, she took me aside, and she said, I just want to warn you that things happen when you achieve success in the ministry. And I remember the man my husband used to be, and I wish I could have him back. Success can be dangerous to our souls. And sometimes, not in the ways that we think. I mean, most of us can identify that ugly form of pride or arrogance or conceit. You know, we see it. People who treat others as though they're worthless. People who love to brag about the things they're doing, who are constantly showing off their accomplishments or their achievements. But most of us don't look at those folks and we recognize right away what's going on there. Often they're people with very low self-esteem who are trying to feel better about themselves by making other people feel poorly about them. Most of us are not in danger of having that kind of arrogance or conceit or pride sort of billowing from us. But I find the temptation is much more subtle in my own life. And it's something that I would try not to let anybody ever see. And yet it plagues my mind, my heart. It's the thoughts and the ability to begin to compare yourself with someone else. And sometimes it's the way that you respond to people and it's the tone of voice you take. And the scripture makes very clear that that isn't the character that God wants his people to have. The scriptures are clear in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. The same witness is born. We read these words both in the book of Proverbs and also in the book of James, that God humbles the proud but gives grace to the humble. We read in the words of Jesus constantly that the first shall be last and the last shall be first, that if any among you would be great, you must first learn to be the servant of all. And of course, Jesus tries to demonstrate this to us when he washes his disciples' feet, saying, I am your teacher and Lord, and I'm setting an example for what I would have you be and do. The word of the Proverbs rings very clear when it says this, pride goes before destruction and haughtiness before a fall. I think that in part was the juxtaposition Luke was trying to present to us in this character, Herod Agrippa I, who refused to acknowledge God and give glory to him, and Paul and Barnabas, who in the one moment of success that they'd achieved, refused to take the glory for themselves, but passed it on to the Lord himself. Now, if pride is the Achilles heel of the Christian, then humility is the antidote. And it's interesting, not just in the Christian life or the spiritual life, but really in any form of life, it's important in any arena of life, it's important that we be cultivating the quality of character we call humility. I was reading this week an article in February's Strategic Finance magazine, not usually a bastion of theological wisdom, but an editorial written by Bob Gunn entitled Level 5 Leaders. And he's quoting from a new Jim Collins book entitled Good to Great, in which Collins reports on a study of 1,400 businesses in America. And of those businesses, he only found 11 that had moved significantly beyond the good that they'd already been doing to a status of great in a whole wide variety of measurements, financial measurements and other business measurements. He found that there were 11 of those companies that had really excelled. They'd moved from being good companies to being exceptional companies under the leaders that they currently had. And as he studied them, he tried to look to see what was the key characteristic of the leaders of those companies. And this is what he wrote. He found that those 11 companies were all led by people who combined great personal humility with a strong will to achieve professionally. Great personal humility, a strong will to achieve professionally. And I thought that was interesting because when I read that line, I thought, that's the Apostle Paul. I mean, the guy had a huge will to achieve professionally. But his goal wasn't to achieve professionally for himself. It was to accomplish the mission God had given him. God had said, I'm going to send you to the world to take the gospel to the Gentiles. And in this, he was relentless. I mean, he wouldn't stop. He was willing to be stoned. He was willing to be shipwrecked. He was willing to be personally wounded. He was willing to risk everything for this mission. He was driven to accomplish these purposes. But he did it with great personal humility. I was reading another article this week by one of my favorite authors, John Cotter, a favorite business author, John Cotter. He was with the Harvard Business School. And this appeared in Harvard Business Review, in the Planning Review. And here he talked about leaders that make a difference. And it was interesting. He listed a whole wide variety of characteristics of leaders, but there was only one quality of character that nearly every leader that makes a difference shares in common. And that was humility. Paul himself gives us this advice in Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. He says, do nothing from selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. And then he goes on to say, and let this mind be in you, which was also with Christ Jesus, who though being in very form God, did not consider equality with God something to be attained or held on to, but instead he humbled himself and he became a servant, giving his life on the cross as a ransom for us. This is how Paul lived. And this is the challenge and the invitation he gives to us. So I'd ask you these questions. In your life, do you really know deep down inside and understand that your life is a gift from God? It seems to me to be one of the prerequisites of humility, is that somewhere along the way we understand that all of our achievements, I mean, it's not that we dismiss them, it's not that we don't savor them, it's not that we don't hang the certificates on our wall from time to time, but somewhere along the way we recognize that everything we are was ultimately a gift from God, that He formed us in our mother's womb, He gave us life experiences, this whole world belongs to God, and we're just renters, we're just tenants here for a time. And so in some sense, everything that we have and are ultimately, the glory for that belongs to God and not to ourselves. And when we do that, when we understand that, when that becomes a part of our heart's understanding, and we give praise to God in everything, we begin to find the strength to allow the quality of character of humility to overcome the temptation to pride. All right, that's the first bridge from Lister to Leawood. Here's the second one I'd like to lift up to you just quickly, and it really came from an email that I received a couple of weeks ago. Jeff mentioned to you the news story most of us read this morning in our paper about Marcia and Martin Burnham. I'm sorry, Martin and Gracia Burnham. My brain is just a little tired tonight. I received this email. How is it we are giving Jesus credit, Adam, for the good things in our lives, but not the evil things? I've been asked this question before. It's an excellent question. My Christian radio station is praying for the release of hostages held overseas, claiming as we trust in God, it will be the Lord's work if they are released. This would indicate to me that the contrary be true also. It would be the Lord's work in or if they are killed. I'm confused. I appreciated the simplicity of that email. And you know what? That's a very confusing thing. And I have been, like many of you, praying for Martin and Gracia Burnham for a long time, even if I didn't remember their names when I first called them tonight. And this question of if we are called to give glory to God for the good things, why we don't blame God for the bad things is very important theologically. Now, I referred this person first to a series of sermons I preached last year, and if you were not here, I'd refer you to them as well, called Where Was God When? The Problem of Evil and the Providence of God, because I can't answer in the 5 minutes that remain in this sermon this question, but I can at least give you some pointers on how I answer it typically. Why we don't blame God for the bad when we give God credit for the good. Well, first, when we give God credit for the good, when I stop before a meal and I thank God for that meal, I don't believe that God prepared that meal for me. I know that LaVon did, or one of the kids, or we're at a restaurant and somebody prepared the meal. I don't believe that God directly brought the harvest to the co-op. I believe there were farmers whose hands who did that. But I still thank God for it. Why? Well, because the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. Because God is the one who designed the weather systems, and God gave us the intellect to be able to reap the harvest. God blesses us with life, and everything that's here on earth, in some sense, belongs to Him. So I recognize that while God doesn't directly provide me those gifts and blessings, He indirectly provides every good and perfect gift. Now, there are moments that God does intervene directly in our lives and gives us these things directly, but generally, God works through people. God works through processes. God works through systems. God works through nature. God accomplishes His purposes in this way. So ultimately, God is responsible for every good and perfect gift, even if directly God is not the one who gives it. So we thank the people who do provide those things. We treat them with respect, and we offer grace to them and love and appreciation. But at the same time, we recognize that ultimately, God is responsible for the blessings that come in life. Last weekend, LaVon and I were in Vail, Colorado. One of our family members offered us, one of our church members offered us their place to stay for our 20th anniversary. So we drove out to Vail, and we had a wonderful four-night stay in this place, and it was beautiful. It's the kind of place I could never afford to build, couldn't even afford, I don't think, to rent it. I mean, it was just beautiful, right on the creek. And we enjoyed it. And we didn't go around saying, hey, look at this cool place we're staying in, you know, this like pretending like it was ours. We didn't put out a little sign to the Hamiltons, you know, when we stayed there for those 4 days. We recognized that we didn't own that place. It was a gift to us. It was a blessing. It was just loaned to us for 4 days. And you know, all you can do with something like that is say thank you. And that's the way really everything is. It's a gift from God. Now, while we were there, we went out and went whitewater rafting. And we had a blast. The picture you're about to see is actually a photograph of our little group in the Dowd Chute. And you can't really see me, I'm on the right in that picture, but we were having a ball. This is a Class 4 Rapids, and we shot it twice, and the first time about bounced out of the boat. And it's kind of scary. Now, had we bounced out of the boat, and had we hurt ourselves, would that have been the fault of the family who loaned us their condominium? We thank them for letting us stay in the condominium, but would we have blamed them if we had fallen out of the boat? Well, of course not. It was our choice to go whitewater rafting. We understood the dangers. We even had to sign a waiver that we wouldn't sue anybody if we got hurt. We knew the danger, and it was part of the risk that made the joy of going down the Dowd Chute even more enjoyable. And that's kind of how it is with life. God gives us this big world with all of the ways that it works, and sometimes the world is dangerous, and sometimes it's dangerous to be alive. If you want a safe life, you build a concrete bunker, and you manage to not build any relationships with any people, and you stay in your bunker, and you pay to have people bring you food every day, and you watch TV, if you want to be safe. Living is a dangerous proposition. It comes with risk. But none of us would want to take away the opportunity to live just for a safe life. None of us are going to go build a concrete bunker. The world in which we live comes with dangers. That's sort of how it works. We were enjoying the mountains, and those mountains were formed by terrible forces that can destroy life. But they also create something, a thing of beauty. And having been to the Grand Canyon and walked down and looked over the edge, knowing how awesomely beautiful it is, I wouldn't trade that for a safe world where there were no floods. And diseases, all of these things are a part of how biology works, a part of the changes that happen that create new species and new life. And so in all of these things, we recognize the risk of living. We recognize the joy and the gift that God has given us. We praise God for the blessings, but we don't blame Him for the things that are painful. We turn to Him, and we find from Him strength. And these are the two bridges I see, from Lystra to Leewood: a call to humility and an invitation to understand that the blessings are from God and the glory goes to Him, and the tough times just go along with life. Here's the interesting rest of the story, if you will. You know what happens at Lystra after they hail him as a god? The folks from Iconium and Antioch come and rile up the people, and they take stones, and they begin to pummel Paul's body until he collapses to the ground. He's left for dead. In the same town, blessing and curses. Paul didn't get up and walk away and blame God because he was owned. He knew that was part of the risk. But he praised God. The scripture says he had joy in his heart and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. Here's the last invitation for you tonight. And this is a totally different point, but I want you to hear it just briefly as we prepare to wrap it up. The people in Antioch were a great church. And here's what they understood, is that Christians are called to the mission field. You know, this is a great church. There have been hundreds of you who have gone out on mission trips, but here's my dream, way down in my heart, is that somewhere along the way, God is going to begin calling some of you to the mission field. To risk everything, to go in full-time Christian service as doctors, or farmers, or preachers, to some place where God's light is little known, and where people haven't heard or seen the word. I wonder which of you God might call to that. And finally, when you walk out the doors tonight, I want you to understand this. All of you are called to the mission field where you live, in your Derby or your Lystra or your Antioch. Let's pray. Oh God, we give you thanks and praise on this day. Thanks and praise because despite our circumstances, some here are at the mountaintop of life, some are way down in the valley of the shadow. Despite our circumstances, you still are God. We recognize that ultimately you carry us through the valleys and don't desert us. And you give us the opportunity to explore the mountaintops. Lord, we give you the glory tonight. You know, O God, that many in this room, myself included, wrestle with pride, wrestle with success. We pray that you would help us. Help us to walk humbly before you. Help us to not consider ourselves better than others, but to look at the needs of others before our own. Help us, O God, to be servants, and not those who wait to be served. Lord, we do lift up to you Martin and Gracia Burnham's family this night, and all of the missionaries around the world who with great courage have heard the call from local churches just like this one and decided to go. And we pray that you might raise up from this congregation people who hear that call. Finally, we pray that you would help us hear that call tonight, that as we leave this church, go back to our homes and our places of work and our neighborhoods, that we might look for ways to give you the glory, to allow people to see you through us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We continue to worship the Lord now as we share with God his tithes and our offerings.
God.
It has been a joy to worship with you on this evening. I want to encourage you to be back next week as we continue in our series of sermons on the life and journeys of Paul. On Father's Day weekend, we're going to be looking at how Paul dealt not with success, but with opposition. What happens when people don't like you? What happens when people do things that hurt you? How do you deal with that as a Christian? We're going to try to connect Paul's life and our lives in that way next week. I hope you'll join us for that sermon. I want to encourage you as you leave tonight to those of you who are not members yet, if you're considering becoming a part of this church family, join us tomorrow for our lunch with the pastor. Would you bow now for the benediction? And now as we leave this place, may we go forth as those who love the Lord with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. May we recognize that it is God's goodness and His mercy that gives us life. And may we walk humbly with Him this day and forevermore. Amen.